And I'm telling you, we're in trouble in America.
Amen.
Because if our nation's future is what you see portrayed on your television screen every day, we're in trouble in this country. We better do what we can to reach that next generation. Let me say to every parent in this room tonight, what your child will get at church will mean more to them than what they get at Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, football, baseball, soccer, beauty pageants, and all the other. And all of that is good in its place. Everything's fine in its place. Notice I didn't say anything about hunting or fishing. And man, what they get in the house of God will carry them all of their lives. I believe what I'm going to preach on tonight is a picture of where we're at in this world in which we live. And I trust the Lord to use it tonight to speak to our heart. The book of Exodus, and I want to begin reading tonight in chapter 1 and verse number 5. Exodus chapter 1 and verse number 5. And all the souls that came out of the loins of Jacob were 70 souls. For Joseph was in Egypt already. And Joseph died, and all his brethren, say this last phrase out loud with me, and all that generation. Say that with me again. And all that generation. You say, Brother Joe, what generation was that? The generation that knew Joseph. The generation that was familiar with the life and legacy of Joseph. It said that that generation died. Notice what happens now in verse number 8. And I believe this is where we are in America tonight. Now there arose up a new king over Egypt. And say this last loud out loud with me. Which knew not Joseph. Let's say that again. Which knew not Joseph. And from this passage, I want to preach tonight for a while on the tragedy of not knowing Joseph. I believe you would agree with me tonight. Joseph, what a man. Joseph, what a life. And Joseph, what a legacy. I believe the name of Joseph is a great name. I believe the story of Joseph is a great story. I believe the legacy of Joseph is a great legacy. If there was a man on the scene today used of God like Joseph was used of God in that day, we would say about that man, he's a man. I mean, if a man was on the scene today, used of God like Joseph was in that day, there would be books written about him. There would be songs sung about him. People would travel all over the nation and give lectures on how wonderful this man by the name of Joseph is. Probably never been a mortal man used of God any greater than this man by the name of Joseph. Because of the anointing of God and the wisdom of God that was upon his life, he saved an entire nation from starvation. There's a country in the world tonight named Egypt that would not be in existence if it were not for this man by the name of Joseph. The Bible says that this man kept much people alive. Egypt would have went into starvation. They would have gone into extinction. But God greatly used this man by the name of Joseph. God not only used this man to save a nation, but God literally used this man to preserve the human seed that would one day bring his greater Joseph, God's son, Jesus, into this world. I'm saying never been a man used was like this man.
Amen.
By the name of Joseph. But yet the text says that there is a ruler over the nation that owes their very existence to Joseph, that did not even know who Joseph was.
Right.
Now, we do know the Bible teaches us that Israel sojourned in Egypt for about 430 years. We know that Joseph was 30 years old when he went to the throne, and he lived to be 110. And so from the time that Joseph died to this new king comes on the scene who does not know Joseph, it is a period of approximately 350 years. Think about this tonight. In 350 years, a nation that owed their very existence to Joseph.
Oh, yes.
In 350 years, they go from knowing all about Joseph to some about Joseph, to a little about Joseph, to nothing about Joseph. Now, 350 years sounds like a long time, but you put that in our American history, and less than the time of the founding of Jamestown, a nation that owed their very existence to Joseph went from knowing all about him, to some about him, to a little about him, to nothing about him. They say a generation is between 40 to 45 years. So less than 8.5 generations. In less than 8.5 generations, a nation that would not be here were not for Joseph, in 8.5 generations, they go from knowing all about Joseph, to some about Joseph, to a little about Joseph, to nothing about Joseph. You say, now, Brother Joe, what is so bad about Egypt not knowing Joseph? Well, not to know Joseph is not to know one of the greatest lives that's ever been lived. And not to know Joseph is not to know one of the greatest stories that has ever been told. And not to know Joseph is not to know one of the greatest heritage and legacies that has ever been left. A man that went from misfortune to mighty fame because he lived of the perpetual blessing of the presence and the anointing and the touch of Almighty God.
Amen.
I mean, whether you put Joseph in a pit, in a prison, Potiphar's, or the palace, he had the smile, the unction, the approval of God upon his life.
Amen.
Joseph, what a life. Joseph, what a man. Joseph, what a legacy. And it's sad that the very nation that owed their existence to Joseph went from knowing all about him, to some about him, to a little about him, to nothing about him. You say, now, Brother Joe, really, now, what is so bad about not knowing Joseph? Well, not to know Joseph is not to know the one that was greatly loved of his father. I mean, not to know Joseph is not to know the one that his father exalted high above all of his other sons. Why, not to know Joseph is not to know the one that his father loved so much he gave him a coat of knitted colors and he would tell the world, "This is my son, in whom I am well pleased." Why? Boy, that was a good point. Why not to know Joseph? I'm hung up on that first point. That's better than what I thought it was going to be. But not to know Joseph is not to know the one that even though he was loved by his father, he was despised and rejected by his brethren. Why not to know Joseph It's not to know the one that was sold into the hand of the enemy for the price of silver. But not to know Joseph. It's not to know the one that suffered humiliation for the sins and the crimes and the faults of another. But not to know Joseph. It's not to know the one that they lied on and they misrepresented. And not to know Joseph is not to know the one that was let down in a pit and was forsaken by all and was left to suffer all alone. But not to know Joseph. It's not to know the one that, although everybody forgot about him, God never did. For not to know Joseph is not to know the one that was lifted out of the pit of suffering. And not to know Joseph is not to know the one that was highly exalted on the other side of his humiliation. Why, not to know Joseph is not to know the one that went to the throne on the other side of the pit. And not to know Joseph is not to know the one that the very ones that despised and rejected him had to bow down before him and confess publicly that Joseph lives and Joseph is Lord of all. Why, not to know Joseph is not to know the one that had bread when nobody else had bread. And not to know Joseph is not to know the one that if you got any bread, you had to bow down to him to get it because he's the only one that had it. And not to know Joseph is not to know the one that all of his promises, prophecies, and predictions were fulfilled to the minute detail. But not to know Joseph. It's not to know the one that took a Gentile bride when he got to the throne. Then they said like this, not to know Joseph. It's not to know the one that brought a bunch of people into something they didn't have no business being brought into. And the only reason why they got brought into it, they knew who Joseph was. Why, not to know Joseph. It's not to know the one that built a place in the palace for him and his bride to live in harmony and blessing as long as Joseph lived. And not to know Joseph, it's not to know the one that sent a message to his other family members, come unto me, where I am, there you may be also. Not to know Joseph, it's not to know the one that sent a message to the family, the mansion's built, the door is open, the table is spread, and the throne is occupied. And not to know Joseph is not to know the one that made a place in the kingdom for all of his family to dwell in with him in happiness and comfort and blessing as long as Joseph lived. They were safe. They were satisfied. They were supplied as long as Joseph lived. Boy, I bet if you ask anybody in that day, do you know who Joseph is? I believe they would say, yeah, boy, I'm glad I know who Joseph is. You say, what has that got to do with us? Praise God, I'm glad I know who Jesus is. Say, Brother Arthur, how do you put Joseph and Jesus in the same setting? Don't you know that the Hebrew name Joseph has a twofold meaning? Yes. Well, I'm glad you brought that up. Brother Joe, don't you realize that first Hebrew meaning of the word Joseph means that Jehovah has taken away my reproach. Exactly. Because ever since I met Jesus, my heavenly Joseph, he has taken away my reproach. You say, Brother Joe, don't you realize that second Hebrew meaning of the name Joseph means Jehovah shall bless or God shall add? I'm glad you brought that up. Because ever since I met Jesus, my heavenly Joseph, he sure has blessed me. He sure has added to me. As Egypt owed their existence to Joseph,
We owe our existence to Jesus Christ. They would be nothing without Joseph. We would be nothing without Jesus. He deserves our praise. He deserves our service. He deserves our worship. And God forbid that we ever live in a society that goes from knowing all about Jesus, the sum about Jesus, to a little about Jesus, to nothing about Jesus. Say, well, what's so bad about not knowing who Jesus is? Well, not to know Jesus is not to know the one that was greatly loved of his heavenly Father. Why, not to know Jesus, it's not to know the one that all three of the Trinity showed up at the same time at his baptism. God the Son being baptized by the baptizer, God the Holy Ghost on the wings of a snow white dove, and God the Father thundering from the glory world with a voice that shook the foundations of the earth. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Not to know Jesus is not to know the one that was highly exalted above all of his other sons. Because Adam was the son of God, and Abraham was the son of God, and I'm a son of God, and you're saved, you're a son of God. But he only had one only begotten Son, and Jesus is his name. You say, preacher, did he give him a coat of many colors? It's better than that. Jesus said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Greatly loved of his Father, exalted of his Father. I know who Jesus is. Oh, but not to know Jesus, it's not to know the one of the subject of John chapter 1 and verse number 11. And he came unto his own, and his own received him not. For not to know Jesus is not to know the one that was despised and rejected by his brethren. While not to know Jesus, it's not to know the one that was sold into the hand of the enemy for the price of silver. They sold Joseph for 20. They sold Jesus for 30. You say, what's all behind that? Well, under that old Hebrew economy, a male slave in his prime was worth 20. A female slave in her prime was worth 30. Every one of you women right now ought to turn and look at your husband and say, I'm worth more than you. You say, but Brother Joe, that doesn't make sense. Joseph being a man sold for 20, yet Jesus being a man sold for 30. The price of a female, is that a discrepancy? No, that's a divine nugget. For when Jesus was being sold for 30 pieces of silver, the price of a female, he was buying himself a bride for eternity. For when Jesus was on this earth, the foxes had holes and the birds had nests, but the Son of Man had no place to lay his head. And when Jesus Christ was on this earth, he bore a wound to be born from. He bore a table to eat at. He bore a bed to sleep on. He bore a boat to preach from. He bore a donkey to ride upon. He bore a cross to die on. He bore a tomb to lay in. When Jesus was on this earth, he didn't buy a piece of real estate. He didn't buy him a coat. He didn't buy him a fleet. The only thing Jesus bought and paid for was your soul and mine. When he bought us at bloody Calvary, I'm glad I know who Jesus is. For not to know Jesus is not to know the one that was placed in a pit of suffering. While not to know Jesus is not to know the one that was forsaken by all and left to suffer all alone. For not to know Jesus is not to know the one that cried in the apex of his suffering, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Yeah. Oh, but not to know Jesus is not to know the subject of Psalm 8, where the Bible said that God would not leave his soul in hell or suffer his Holy One to see corruption. For not to know Jesus is not to know the one that was lifted out of the pit of suffering. While not to know Jesus is not to know the one that up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph for his foes. And not to know Jesus is not to know the one that went to the throne on the other side of the cross. Not to know Jesus is not to know the subject of Philippians chapter number 2, where it said, wherefore God hath highly exalted him and given him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, just like they had to do Joseph, they had to bow before all of Egypt and say, Joseph lives and Joseph's Lord. One day every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus lives and Jesus is Lord. Not to know Jesus, it's not to know the one that took a Gentile bride when he got to the throne. Let me say it like this. Not to know Jesus is not to know the one that brought a bunch of people into something they didn't have no business being brought into. And the only reason why they got brought into it, they knew who Jesus was. Not to know Jesus, it's not to know the one that's built a place in the palace for him and his bride to live together in forever and forever and forever. And not to know Jesus, it's not to know the one that's about to send a message to all the other family, come unto me where I am, that you may be also. The mansion's built, the door is open, the throne is occupied, the table is spread. For not to know Jesus is not to know the one who said, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you. And not to know Jesus is not to know the one that's built a place in the palace for his family to dwell together in harmony and blessing throughout all eternity, as long as Jesus lives. Someone said, Brother Joe, how long are we saved? We're saved as long as Jesus lives. And the last time I read my Bible, that's a long